Well, I'm 56 years of age, and I would say that I've had continual sequence of pain for the last 25 years. In actual fact, the first incidence of pain was when I was 21, when I had an attack of what was diagnosed as lumbago after a bout of tennis. And I think it's safe to say that by the time I was conveniently found then to be suffering from spondylitis, and had been all the time, I was in a pretty continuous state of pain, which was really crippling and severe, and of course particularly night times. But I did have this problem that the pain was continually extending to other joints. I remember the first two casualties were ankles, which began to swell and sometimes prevent me walking. And then I had a particularly bad attack in the left shoulder, which after 20 years is really pretty well frozen, so that I'm told most of the movements on the left shoulder are by the use of the shoulder blade joint. I also had quite a severe extension of this pain to the whole of the spine, particularly in the back of the neck. I live in a cottage in Seaford. It has become necessary for me to live downstairs and to sleep downstairs within the last 2 years because of the incidence of pain, particularly at night. Naturally, I'm a right shoulder sleeper, but as I've got the pretty severe outbreak of trouble in the right shoulder, I'm trying to sleep either on my neck or on my left shoulder, and in doing this I'll get a pressure build up which will wake me.
First of all, I had an ulcer which was cured with drugs. Next thing I knew, I had arthritis. Very few people realize the amount of pain and stiffness that one has to go through during the night. As I lay my head on the pillow, I can find it very, very difficult to raise again. If I try to turn left or right, both my shoulders hurt. And it is this stiffness which is the main part of this disease. It's the pain that you get from this awful stiffness, which is, unfortunately, I have it all over me. And consequently, I can get very little relief from pain.
But if he recognised, in fact, well, he suspected that I had rheumatoid arthritis, I was then 19. I always seemed to be acutely conscious of the burning type of pain in the wrist. Probably the shoulders and around the back of the neck there is about the most. Certainly not in the hip, though. But then I usually go into bed at such an extraordinarily late hour. It has to be fairly acute, you know, before I can feel it. And which is marvellous, you know, because it means that I have no worries about not being able to go to sleep because I'm in pain, which is superb and which certainly didn't apply before.
First it started in my hands. Apart from my hands are painful, and my wrists. It went up to my elbow, and then to my shoulders, then the back of my neck, eventually my back. Varies. Sometimes it's in my shoulders, sometimes it's in my hands, sometimes in my feet, sometimes in my knees, but mostly in my back. Sometimes I can't always sleep, whether it's myself that I get overexcited or whether it's just the pain.
The awful part is the waking up part. That really is dreadful. Unfortunately, if your brain goes quicker than your movements, naturally you get much more pain. Anyway, there's the stiffness, the worry, will I get out of bed, will I be able to do this or that? And then gradually you sort of pull yourself into it. I find I have to get up and circulate around a little to get the stiffness away. Then I'll probably get up and have a cigarette. I've got the drugs well organized now. I have 4 yellow capsules during the day and 4 at night, which help me terrifically. Then I also have pain-killing tablets, which I only take when it's necessary.
The first thing I have done for the last 2.5, 3 years, I suppose, is take a pill since I wake up. But this takes a while to take effect, so it For me, it seems about 20 minutes before I really feel the benefit of it. But this didn't help me get through the first 20 minutes of waking up. And I tend to like my bed very much in the morning, and I don't get out of it. I have a, you know, I did a critical path a long time ago, and I now know exactly the last second that I can stay in bed and still make it, you know. Because I like to be at work fairly early. I'm usually at work about 8:15, and, you know, I know the exact last second, and then everything is geared, because I don't eat breakfast. So it's a beautifully structured program, and I'm very annoyed if anybody ever interferes with it. And every piece of action, in fact, has a part in the program. Now, all of this, I would be conscious of pain, and it's, you know, it's like living in a grey envelope for the first part of the morning, for the first half hour that one wakes up. And, you know, you get used to it. I've never not known it for the last few years, so I'm not unhappy about it, just part of getting up. After about half an hour, the grey envelope dissolves, and it's much better.
It took me a good few minutes to roll out of bed. Fortunately, I've got a divan bed. Then that's when I had to start doing the rocking, and all I could say was, "Oh my hands, oh my hands, oh my hands," because I couldn't understand what was going wrong or what had happened. And then eventually, first one part of me and then the other loosens up sufficiently for me to walk.
I live in a house where the bathroom and the loo and the kitchens are all downstairs, two flights of stairs. This was very bad, getting down those stairs. Not very bad now, it's just I take it pretty slowly. I don't like it. It's the one part of the day which I don't look forward to, the going downstairs in the morning.
I reckon to wake up every morning in pain. It's usually a severe sort of pain that comes from the joint that's been most slept on. And when I wake up, I find the best thing to do is just to get up, move around, make a cup of tea, take a dose of painkillers, which I think will not interfere with my morning work. But I have found that increasingly over the years, I'm getting into a tremendous state of non-dependence on sleep. And by that, I mean that I would say that I've averaged about 3 to 4 hours sleep in 24.
You develop, I suppose everybody must have developed their own way of adapting to the situation in terms of the ordinary human functions like getting dressed. For example, putting on tights, I just lie on the bed, sit on the bed completely. It's great, you do it in a horizontal position practically. Bras are not very good, that's difficult. And the shoulder muscles give quite a lot of pain. Zips are pretty bad. Fortunately, my father had a pub, and there are always masses of people around, but I tended never to buy any clothes that I couldn't, in fact, step in and out of, or unbutton. But if I did happen to have something with a zip, then I'm afraid some poor man got woken up and he just had to do something about it, or somebody had to do something about it. I think I only ever remember being depressed once, and that really was because some agent sort of felt so sorry for me. I suddenly thought, well, maybe I should be worried about something. But up till then, I had just, and always still do, in fact, regard it as just being a part of life. And it has certainly never stopped me from doing anything I really want to do. It just means that there are certain movements which are limited. I never woke up in the night utterly depressed about it, ever.
Fortunately, I have a separate room to my husband. He manages to get some sleep in the other room. And apart from that, I never feel human until I've had my bath first thing in the morning. It's not regular as I used to be able to get up and get in the bath myself at 7 in every morning. Well, now I have to wait, and I more or less have one about 8:30 or 9 o'clock, because I have to have help into the bath and help out of the bath. But there's no joy in sleeping, there's no joy in waking. In fact, the sleeping part is by far the worst part of this disease, I think. Personally, I mean, I always wish, I think, oh my God, not another night. Instead, and when you wake up and you think to yourself, oh, not another day. It's really very, very mentally distressing. That's the whole thing.
There's no joy in sleeping. There's no joy in waking. Oh, God, not another night. And when you wake, oh, God, not another day. This really is pain at night, isn't it? This is the satanic cocktail, a mixture of pain, misery, depression, which we've all seen so often. This grey envelope that one of the patients speaks about. So now I'd like to hear what the panel have to say about this film. And I'll introduce them, first of all, if I may. Dennis Brackenridge, who's in general practice in Boston, Lincolnshire. And Dr. George Brown, who's in South London in general practice. And Dr. Edward Huskisson, who works here in Westminster as a research worker in rheumatology. Dennis, what are your immediate views?
I regard the promotion of sleep, never mind mere analgesia, as being a terribly important factor in our treatment of these patients.
We find that the stronger hypnotics, although they may give the patient a better night's sleep, will often cause very severe morning stiffness.
This is one of the reasons why I tend not to use barbiturates and to use the simple chloral derivatives, even chloral hydrate itself. There is a case, of course, too, for in the depressed, rather anxious patient to use tranquilizers into the bargain. I think that diazepam has a very useful part to play. Fairly big doses this time. It doesn't seem to upset them quite so much, and it does help them to relax. As far as the tricyclic antidepressants are concerned, I've rather gone off these. I used to use them a tremendous lot, but not in such great quantity now for rheumatoids. I don't think that they are quite as good as the tranquilizers themselves.
There's no doubt that the depressed patient, waking about 4 or 5 in the morning, has a terrible time just looking blankly at the ceiling and having the pain from her shoulders and other places and just seeing no future in it. And the depression mounts like anything at this time. But coming to the actual pain relief, because the arthritics, the rheumatoids, the spondylitics, the polymyalgia rheumaticas, the discs, they all have a lot of pain at night, and quite apart from the sleep part of it, it's pain, sheer old pain that keeps them awake. What about that?
Well, certainly the morning stiffness is a particular feature of the disorders which are characterized by inflammation. And in these disorders, it seems to be the anti-inflammatory drugs which have a particular place in relieving night pain and morning stiffness. Although we did see a patient taking an analgesic first thing in the morning, this is not usually sufficient for a patient with severe morning stiffness. It's the last dose at night that's the important dose. And in our experience, indomethacin in a large dose provides the most useful relief of this, second only to a small dose of steroids, which we tend to avoid as far as possible.
But a small dose of steroids, and the sort of dose you give at night, doesn't depress the adrenals, as bigger dosage does, and doesn't have a lot of adverse effect on the patient. So you would say that small dose steroids or big dose indomethacin feed through to the morning and keep the mornings free of morning stiffness better than most drugs.
I was wondering what your feelings are about enteric-coated steroids, which are supposed to be released later on in the night, so that their effect is felt mainly in the morning when the gelling problem is at its most. We use these from time to time with very good effect, whereas a single soluble tablet last thing at night sometimes does not seem to cover the early mornings to the same extent.
But as regards the question of whether you give it by mouth or give it by suppositories.
Well, our study showed that the capsules in a large dose were more effective than suppositories in a significant proportion of cases. This, of course, provides the opportunity for bypassing suppositories, which many patients, certainly in this country, seem to dislike. Patients with rheumatoid arthritis often find it difficult to insert the suppositories. They cause rectal ulceration sometimes.
But it's still a jolly good way of taking an effective drug because it gets absorbed just as readily by that route as any other. What about any other painkillers? Is it true the ordinary aspirin compound works off too quickly to go right through to the morning?
Yes, the delayed action aspirin, loxifen preparation, is effective in relieving morning stiffness, possibly because it has a longer duration of action. Certainly the more longer acting drugs like phenylbutazone are effective in relieving morning stiffness, but only as part of their action, which is slow throughout the 24 hours and gradually builds up.
Because these patients do suffer essentially from a mixture of stiffening and pain which becomes maximal after maximal immobility through the night. And I think this is the message. Spondylitis, rheumatoid arthritis, polymyalgia rheumatica, the elderly man or woman of 70 wakes up absolutely rigid in the shoulder girdle. And this is hell. And some patients just can't go through the night. They must have something to enable them to remain to supple up in the night. Mm. And this is, I think, why your long-acting anti-inflammatory agent works, because they are able to do simple movements in their sleep which would wake them otherwise.
Even the stronger narcotic drugs we found were very much inferior to the anti-inflammatory drugs in relieving.
Mm. And you would be against those, by and large, would you not, using anything under the DDA, the dangerous drug there?
I'd like to think that I've never used them, in actual fact. And I think that the expectation of life with these people is so long. I think it's all right if you have somebody whose nights are being disturbed by secondary carcinomatosis with a short expectation of life. But if you've got somebody who has chronic pain that's going to go on for many years, I think you're starting the downward path far too early.
What we really want is something to last 12 hours, yes. And at the moment we haven't got it, have we?
What about alcohol?
Yes, I'm a great believer in alcohol in small doses. I think it very often, for the patient who is used to it, will settle them down at night. And certainly if somebody wants to have a whiskey before they go to bed, I wouldn't object to it in the slightest.
Because it is night we're talking about. And a mixture of a little alcohol and one of these drugs at night is fairly safe, where in the day it certainly would not be. I think the patient knows best what's good for his pain, really, because he has the pain. And that particular patient sitting back in his armchair had pretty bad hips, and that position in that chair was better for the hips, perhaps not quite so good for the spine, but he's the only one who can equate the two.
Yeah. The other thing that I noted in that film was that so many of them were in single beds. I think that this is a factor that one finds, that anybody moving in the bed is sufficient to disturb the other partner. And if they are sleeping lightly because of pain, they can get a better night's sleep.
I come from a relatively country area where there's still an enormous number of feather beds about, and it's surprising how many elderly people with rheumatism, more particularly with osteoarthritis, are sleeping in feathers. They find it very, very difficult to move about. I was interested to see in the film that we saw just now that the younger girl had a layer of about 5 blankets on her bed, and I would have thought she'd been very much better off with a cage to take some of the weight off her legs.
And possibly an electric over blanket, which very light does keep them warm in the very cold months.
I think that there's a very good case for keeping some people still. Again, in the film, there were 3 people who were complaining of rheumatoid pain in their wrists, and none of them were wearing night splints. There's one woman with her wrists like this, and if she'd had them out like this a bit more, she might have been a lot more comfortable.
But she might also have tried them and found them to great help.
Well, I think there are a lot of minor physical methods like this that one can use to make patients' lives more tolerable without getting involved in difficult pharmacology.
And earplugs, they help very much. And things across the eyes to protect glare and light coming in from the window. There are any number of simple home remedies that enable sleep to come and filter off some of the pains.
I thought that one saw these patients doing all the wrong things, but obviously this is what they had adjusted themselves to and found out to be the right way to get their relief. Anybody at home, by very simple means, can support a soft bed if they don't need to buy a hard bed. Just folding a blanket over and over so that it is 9 inches wide, put across just above the hips so that it will give some support in the back there. A cardboard box in the end of the bed when the ankles and feet are particularly painful or they're having difficulty in turning over.
Well, in summary, really, this is what most patients do. They live a life of pain, anything 20, 30, 40 years, and they live it alone for the most part, and this film has shown just how they do live it, and how they manage and how they get along. And what we're discussing tonight is today is how we can help their nights and help them to get through these nights and get out into the morning's work more effectively. And Ted has remarked on the anti-inflammatory agents, the small dose of corticosteroids, such as prednisolone, the indomethacin suppository or capsules. Dennis has referred to antidepressant and sedative drugs, and George to analgesics. All patients find what suits them best, and it's our job to put all available things to them in the most effective form. But finally, it's trial and error, as we've seen in this particular film. And I would like to show you now a man with ankylosing spondylitis who at one time did have a great deal of night pain, but who now is relatively painless, and who, though completely stiff as a result of his ankylosing spondylitis, is able to lead a full and productive life.
In the early stages, when I was seeking advice from my GP, I found that they didn't really understand the problems of the pain which one gets. I sought advice from our doctor, and she just told me that I should get up and play football. Naturally, this was rather upsetting because I would delighted to have done that anyway. one doesn't probably realise the difficulty that two fixed hips bring about when it comes to dressing. There is the problem of getting socks on and off. This I do by laying on the bed and pulling up my feet to my back. Then, of course, there is the difficulty in putting on one's trousers. This I have to hold so that the top of the trouser is exposed to me. After a while, we purchased a bungalow, and the state of the bungalow was rather depressing, but we thought that we're young and we would like to decorate it and improve it over a number of years. And I gradually got more interested in doing things about the house. I installed the central heating in my own bungalow, and since this I have also installed it in four other properties of friends round about me. And then we set about the rather larger problems of making good the walls, and then of course this led to the removal of the fire breast on the outside of the bungalow, which involved climbing on top of the roof. I have also a large garden. During the summer there's the lawn to be cut, and takes about 2 hours to go over the job. When I dig, as I cannot bend down, I get down on my knees, and with the aid of strength in the arm I can push in the shovel or fork, whatever it is, into the required depth of a spit, and then just lever it up and turn it over and continue along a road. I am a photographer and find that photography is quite a good occupation for my particular complaint. I have an invalid carriage, and this enables me to get about rapidly from A to B. With the strength of arm, of course, I find this quite easy to handle, and therefore it maintains my employment, because without it I would not be able to get about on location. Some of the jobs that I have to do involve climbing about on board ships. In the past 3 years I haven't missed a day's work, and in fact I can't remember the last time I was away due to my particular complaint. I find that if ever I have any pain, that I always think that there are people far worse than me. I never think of giving in. You know, I always plan quite a long way ahead as to what I'm going to knock down next.